Welcome to Ask the Expert. My name is Christopher and I'm your host. With me today I have Alex Newman, who's a acoustician in our R&D department. Alex, can you talk a little bit about what it is that you do at Dynaudio?
Yeah, I'll try and put it briefly. I'm an acoustic engineer and my main job is to tune the speakers and the sound of the speakers. In that task, it involves a lot of different things from start to the beginning of a project. And from the start, it's coordinating between other departments, mechanical yeah. engineers, drivers, and choosing what we're going to start with and what's best for this project. And that takes a lot of preparation.
Yeah.
And then after that, we start building up prototypes, measuring, listening. And I think the majority of the time we spend listening to our loudspeakers, testing if something doesn't sound right, we go back to different departments or to whatever we were doing and figure that out. Yeah, and then it's different for active and passive designs. So for a passive speaker, we'll do a lot of the hand electronics and measuring the speaker and soldering and then listening to that and changing
lots of
iterations. Yeah, hands-on work. And for active, it's a lot more digital processing and playing with tools to improve the speaker that way.
Cool. The topic for today, Alex, is passive crossovers.
Yes.
And we're going to dive into what they are and how they work and why we use them and all of that stuff. So I think that we should start out with just the basic question. Why are they there? What's their purpose?
Yeah, so the passive crossover is there to split the frequency regions of a tweeter and a woofer.
Mm.
So the woofer plays bass and a tweeter plays high frequencies, treble. When you have more a three-way system, you have a mid-range, then you need another electrical crossover to split that again. And the reason we do that is because otherwise they will share the same frequency range and we can get distortions and lots of other problems. And I think the most important for the tweeter is if we don't have a crossover on the tweeter, it can blow up, it can burn up, it can be lots of problems. And the woofer, again, it's trying to knit that with the tweeter.
So it's making sure that you take the musical signal and actually divide it to go to the right part of the speaker, right?
Yeah, so it sounds natural.
Yeah.
We want to design the crossover so that it can't be heard.
Mm.
And then after that, so the speaker can't be heard at all.
That sounds like a tricky challenge.
It is a very tricky challenge, but that's what we pride ourselves on trying to do.
How do you approach something like trying to, because it's a pretty central part of the speaker, right?
Yes.
And so trying to eliminate it, if you understand me correctly, how do you go about that?
So a lot of the time we start off by measuring the loudspeaker and measuring the frequency response and the time response and looking for something that's close to ideal of what we want. And when we get that, we get a good knit, as we call it.
A good what?
A knit.
A knit.
So how they blend together.
Ah, yeah.
So if we were to do a tone that went all the way from the bass to the treble, we wouldn't hear something strange. It would just be naturally going from bass to treble. And that's the part where the crossover comes into play, where it really needs to be spot on.
Mm.
But sometimes listening tests change that. So we measure it and it might look brilliant on paper from how we measured it, but then we go listen to it and we can hear the crossover. And it sounds strange. Maybe there's too much mid-range or there's not enough depth. And so from then on, we start changing components to improve those parts. And we take it back and measure it. And a lot of the time when we measure it after listening to it, it sometimes measures better than it did originally. Just from us listening to it and tuning it again.
There's one thing that that stuck with me. You said something about, you know, it has sound, and you said you could hear it, and I'm like, how do you hear a crossover? And I'm a novice, so to me it sounds strange that you can hear it, and I don't even know if you can explain what it is. That it's probably expertise too.
I think the most obvious way is when in frequency response, the region where they cross over sometimes seems emphasized or is lacking. That's the most obvious. That's the easiest to hear. You can straight away hear, maybe it's a bit distorted. But the tricky part, and I think the most important part, is listening for the time response. So the speakers are different sizes, and they also move at different rates. But when they get close together, they're supposed to move at the same time, together. And then when that gets to you, it's supposed to be a summation of both drivers.
Yeah.
And when that's out, when the timing is out, you can hear that in certain things like snare drums or anything transient a lot of the time. And it sounds unnatural.
And that's the things that you're then listening for?
Yeah.
And trying to figure out, okay, so there's an emphasized frequency area here. So now you actually know where you have to go in and fiddle around with the passive crossover, right?
Exactly. So we listen to that. We kind of know, we have good guesses of what components will change what and how it'll affect the rest of the speaker. Because it always, you change one thing, it changes another.
Yeah.
So we have an idea, but sometimes it takes some iterations to discover what we want.
You were talking about, you know, certain things that you can change and parts of the passive crossover. Yeah. Can you walk me through what a passive crossover actually consists of?
Yeah, so a passive crossover is made up of multiple electrical components, such as resistors, capacitors, and inductors. And all of these components electrically change the signal that's coming into it before it goes to the drivers. And we use inductors and capacitors to roll off the frequencies we don't want. So we use a capacitor in series on a tweeter to roll off the low end so that we don't have loads of bass going into the tweeter. And then for the woofer, we use an inductor in series to roll off the high end.
Yeah.
And that's how we manage it. The resistors we use to balance a lot of the time. So it's just padding and changing the levels of the tweeter.
Okay.
But there is also other places. Crossovers can be very complex.
Yeah.
The one I just described was a simple first order, no fuss crossover. But there can be tens of components. I think the aim a lot of the time is to reduce the amount of components we use. Each component adds more coloration.
Yeah.
And sometimes it also can affect the way we hear the music, even.
And I guess that every time you add something, what you're actually doing is tampering a little bit with the music signal, right?
Yes.
As you said, you're coloring it, changing what was recorded in the studio, just a tiny little bit. But I mean, it's all something that we can hear when we're listening afterwards in our living rooms, right?
Yeah.
And the next thing you said was, it's first order. And I guess you're talking about topology now, right?
That's correct, yes.
And I've heard about first order, second order, third order, fourth order.
Can keep going. In passive, maybe not.
So is that just about all of the components that you put in?
It's to do with how you arrange the components and how many you put in. So the one I described was just an inductor on the woofer and a capacitor on the tweeter. That's first order. That gives you a slow roll off. So the bass doesn't sharply end from the tweeter, say.
No.
It slowly goes. When you add another inductor to that circuit in parallel, it gets a bit complicated, but when you add it, we get a steeper slope.
Okay.
So the cutoff is faster. And we use that to control the frequency response of the tweeter. And we can also play with the shape it makes. The shape of the frequency response.
Okay.
And that's by changing values of each component. The less components, the better group delay we have, which means the better timing.
Okay.
And we like to have really good timing at Dynaudio. We aim for that. But sometimes it's necessary to have second order, where it works better for that driver in that enclosure, in that speaker. And depending on what we're aiming for, sometimes we compromise and go for a second order because it sounds better.
And I guess that, as with everything you were talking about earlier, that choices means that there's things that you don't choose. And it's a compromise from all of the different parts that go into a loudspeaker.
Yep.
And it's not just that we focus especially on the drive units or especially on the crossover. It really is the whole nine yards, right?
I think a lot of it changes how we work with the crossover.
Yeah.
Feet is a really good example.
Feet
on a floor standing loudspeaker changes our perception a lot.
Mm.
So we might say you were listening to it without the feet. The mid-range might sound really present or gritty, for lack of a better word. And once you add the feet, it cleans up. But if we were to tune that loudspeaker without the feet, we would have been changing the crossover. This is wrong, trying to fix it. And we would have done it incorrectly, because once you add the feet, it sounds fine.
It's a lot of work.
Yeah, so we need to consider all the factors. And something we try to do is have all our reference parts and all the actual parts we're building a loudspeaker with to tune it with.
Yeah, before you go into that process, right?
So that we know when we start tweaking, we know we're making the right decisions.
Okay. I'm talking about us usually preferring first order. Is that just a general rule? Is that because that is just what we prefer? Or does it give us an advantage?
It gives you advantage in terms of the timing response of the loudspeaker. It has less effect on the way it moves. And that, in essence, can give you better imaging and better depth.
Yeah.
But sometimes the disadvantages of first orders is that the power handling of the loudspeaker is compromised, or we get too much low frequency in the tweeter, for example. And also sometimes the whole back to hearing the crossover, sometimes that's influenced by having a first order.
Okay.
So sometimes we step it up to a second just to improve the sound or improve the timing. Sometimes we have a better timing response if we use a second order.
And timing response, you mentioned that was for the imaging. So it's really, if that's not in place, in a good place, it becomes more difficult to pinpoint instruments, voices in the sound image, correct?
Yeah, that's correct. So a lot of the time we focus on imaging and depth and width and all that kind of stuff, rather than focusing on so much of the frequency response, because that part we can balance.
Mm.
That part's easier to balance. The depth is harder to gain. And sometimes lower order crossovers gain more depth.
Okay.
Or better imaging. But like I said, there can be times where it's compromised.
Mm.
And so maybe we want a more precise image where, say, the vocals are right in the middle. Sometimes the second order can achieve that.
Okay. And it's really about what you're trying to achieve, right? And then
exactly.
It's choosing stuff and then not choosing other stuff.
Yeah.
To try and meet that goal.
Yeah. That's very true. But I think the main part it evolves around is the drivers. And so a lot of the new products we're coming out with are using similar drivers.
Okay.
Similar technologies within them with some changes.
Mm.
And that means the drivers are quite close in the way they act.
Mm.
So that it ends up being we use similar topologies for those drivers because they sound the best. For that,
and it's from what you've been telling me, just it sounds like if you have something that's already, it shares technologies, it shares a lot of the design basics. That's going to be easier for the crossover to deal with, and it's going to be easier for you to design.
It's easier to start with.
Yeah,
it's a good tool to be able to use to give yourself a direction where to go. Because sometimes you can start something and go, well, where should we go with this?
You were talking about new products, and I can hear that they just started a sound demo of the new conference that we're previewing. So I think that we should try and wrap up. And the final thing I want to ask you is, it might be tough, what is the single most important thing in your mind in a passive crossover?
In a passive crossover? Quality of components.
Yeah. Perfect. Thank you so much for joining us, Alex.
Yeah.
No, it's a pleasure. And I won't take any more of your time, so you need to head out and experience the high-end show, right?
Need to look around a bit
more. Yeah. Thank you so much for watching, and keep the questions coming.